Welcome to yet another episode of Focus Hive. I'm your host, Ravi Verma.
Hello, people. I'm your co-host, Shivakant Pandey. And as usual, we are here to bring you another story about something very exciting today. Cool. So I will not reveal the topic as of yet. We will play a short game.
Sure.
And through that game, we will learn what the topic is. Okay?
Sure.
Are you ready?
I am, yes.
Okay. I'm going to say some statements to you, and I would want you to decipher those statements and tell me what you think. Okay?
Okay.
Your yoga teacher is flexible and enterprise tape library is not. What do you think?
Your yoga teacher is flexible, but the enterprise tape library is not.
Tape library is not. Yes. What do you think from this statement? Many things, right?
Yeah, plenty of things. I mean, it's the perspective that you carry on at that time. Actually define the meaning.
Right. Okay. So the next statement is, and it has to be a quick one. You have to answer this one pretty quickly.
Okay.
The statement is, name any tech product that does not encourage collaboration in some or other way.
Television.
Okay. How many times you have called a friend to tell them how empowered you feel because of a tech product?
Never.
Okay. To say your product is scalable and you like sticking out your arm and saying I caught a big fish, how many times you say this, your product is scalable, or how many times you say that you are scalable?
I doubt I've ever had such conversation with anyone.
Okay, awesome. All right, so I'll probably end this rapid fire round.
Okay.
So during our conversation, you might have realized that I asked you certain questions, made mm-hmm. some statements, and trying to think in certain direction, right?
Right.
When you were thinking, you were conscious what answer would you give to either first portray your image or second give the correct answer. Is that right?
That is right.
Okay, cool. So the today's topic is about words can kill.
Words can kill. Okay.
Words can kill.
I hope I did not kill you.
No, you did not. You did not kill me. But think about the game that we just played mm-hmm. 2 seconds back. Mm-hmm. Had I not used certain words, for example, flexible, empower, collaboration, scalable, and had you not heard these terms before, would you have thought about what would be the outcome or what would be the answer to those terms, right? Because when I've been in the industry for a long time, we had heard and used this word quite some time in our conversations or in our email or any professional languages, right?
Right, right.
And when we talk about words, the very first thing that comes to my mind is, can you really correlate words with body language? Is that something that is possible? Can you correlate? Actually not.
Yeah, this is something of importance, right? I mean, for me, yes, I do correlate words with the body language, but there are good mm-hmm. players as well who would kind of hide away and not portray that.
And the good players who hide the words through body language, they are brilliant in their psychology. They have read psychological thinking mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and they know how mind is going to perceive certain conditions. So let's take another example. Let's say if you got a text message from a friend and you're super busy, you cannot pay attention to that text message, but just because you have picked up your phone and you've seen that message, either you're bound to reply or bound to just pick up some specific word in the statements and then mm-hmm. craft a meaning out of it, right?
Right.
So people who understands the function of mind, how the left brain and right brain work, they would choose to use particular words that a mind is tuned to intercept, right? Mm-hmm. And the words that we, I mean, the games that we just played is perfect example of how mind would read certain things. When I said the first statement, your yoga teacher is flexible, but your enterprise tape library guy is not so much. Mm-hmm. Probably you were focusing on yoga teacher, flexible, enterprise. These four words primarily, not rest of the conjunctions or any other words that were used in the statements. That is primarily because a mind is tuned to listen to something which we already know, or maybe we have known this for some time here. And this particular thinking applies a lot in our personal life and in the professional life as well. So, for example, when we do our one-on-one with somebody in our team, if a person is not motivated, how do we motivate a person? How do we use certain words that would just cheer up the other side of the person's mind and he would start performing pretty well there?
No, I mean, in order to get the conversation going, right, we generally try to break the ice in the one-on-ones, and then, I mean, we give some kind of compliment or just get the conversation going. That's the whole agenda there. And then probably come to the terms of what the actual discussion would be. But yeah, as you said, it's important that we get them talking, because if they're not talking, then it's a challenge.
True, that's a challenge. And to overcome through that challenge, a mentor or the manager or a leader has to use certain words so that the guy would open up. So you might be clearly remembering the sessions that we just had a few days back on the leadership.
Yep.
The particular words that you choose in your questions, what, how, why, and those five whys and their husband.
Yes.
Those particular words, where do you fit in? How do you fit in? And in what context do you fit in? Is that something that is very relatable to our professional world? And to a lot extent, it is also relatable to our personal life as well.
Absolutely.
I'm going to give you an example on the personal life. I was just reading an article a few weeks back, and there's one article which struck me through my mind, and I still clearly remember those words used in that article. And let me share you some very interesting story here. In 2014, a couple was just engaged maybe six months back, and they were just talking over the phone.
Okay.
The male guy, the person who were in one of the couple, the person who was driving the car, that guy committed a suicide. And the other side of the person was the responsible person of committing the suicide. And the reasons are because the other side of the person who was on the phone in one of the couple, they shared some text messages which were provoking enough for a person to commit a suicide. And those text messages were, one of them were, and I want you to listen very carefully. The message was, "I thought you wanted to do this, the time is right and you're ready, you just need to do it." This was a text message forwarded by the person to the other side of the person in the couple. And this text provoked the suicide attempt. And how the suicide attempt was taken, I would not talk about that. But when the person who was alive, when police caught that person and they got convicted in the court, and then whole text message series was opened, they realized that how psychological thinking of one person is super important to play someone's mind. And this particular story, this is just one story of somebody goading to commit a suicide and just through text messages, right? And this is one of the powerful ways somebody would eventually provoke somebody to do something. And since this is primarily on the personal stuff, the pure and important part here to learn from this thing is, how do you use certain words in your personal and professional life as well? you could demotivate a person or you could motivate a person through those words. And the word or the statement that I just said, those were the killer words for the person to just pick up and do something about his life, his or her life.
Right. So, I mean, this is kind of somewhat engineering the mind in terms of how you play with the emotions by telling somebody something repeatedly.
Yes.
Now, what I believe is words definitely play a very vital mm-hmm. role in things, but it's the timing of when you are saying or writing something, right? What I'm trying to say is that my trigger points, right? If you know my trigger points, and if you play with that using your words, then it's the most effective weapon, which is what might have happened with the woman or the man who killed himself. But I mean, there was a game, right, around the same lines where they were playing with the child's psychology and making them do stuff, and then eventually they would commit suicide. So I think it is around those lines. But I mean, when you shared this topic, I didn't know that we were going to go in this direction of discussion, where it's more of emotional engineering or psychological engineering of a person's mind.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's really deep, and it's important that we understand how easily it can be done as well if you know the person on the other side.
Yeah, exactly. And now let's turn this around, and if you talk about our corporate life, right? You remember one of our great mentor, he shared a model. That model, although it is not so well known in the industry, but the model is do well, do differently.
Yes.
Right. When you share some important message to the person whom you're talking to, the particular model, do well, do differently, plays a crucial role there.
Yeah.
How do you portray your messages? How do you say something to a person that would give him some soothing experience, or would probably put him in a further depression mode if not using correctly there?
Absolutely. I mean, it kind of puts the person in a good mindset, because you're not asking him what went bad or why you didn't do this or why you didn't do that. Instead, this framework that we are talking about, do well, did well and do differently, is very positive in itself. So
right.
Though it's not widely used, maybe it's used, it's not just not widely spoken about, and it's one of the great methods or great tools of feedbacks. So yeah, I agree to your point on that.
Cool, awesome. So let me share one of my experiences in the recent past. I was just taking an interview for a candidate recently, and so we were on video chat, and we were talking about how things are going at your corporate life and personal life, and what are the things that you do. I was about to use a word called routine. Quite often an interviewer would ask, right, what's your daily routine at your work, what do you do, in other words. I was about to use the word routine, but that before using that particular word, it kind of struck me that I should not use that word, and I should ask, how do you handle failures at work? Because the intent of asking your daily routine is that if something fails, how would you handle it? And if you know the answer of how would you handle failures at work, probably it will give you more insights about the person and also give you some more details about how the other side of the person is thinking about the role, the responsibilities, the company, about yourself. This is something I had experienced pretty recently there, and when you share it. Sure, I thought to use something pretty differently and figure out what, and to my surprise, I actually got my answer there, because the intent of my question was to understand how a person would change his strategy in his or her work. When something comes along the way, maybe some impromptu work or about doing something which is not as a part of the daily routine, how would somebody handle it?
And with this, I mean, words and feelings, I had never had this experience, but I just wanted to share this, what had happened with me once, right? I mean, words would really not hurt you unless you know the meaning.
Yes.
Right? So this, I experienced it in Bangalore. Right. So what had happened is, I mean, all my life I was there in the Hindi speaking side of the country, and that side, everybody is, all the Hindi speakers are dominating over every other language. So or people from every other language. So young chap, I moved to Bangalore as an employee, and me and a couple of my friends, we were just roaming around on the road in the evening, and suddenly one taxi driver comes from behind. And we were like walking like, you know, right, jerks on the road, occupying a lot of space. The taxi driver was behind us, and then suddenly he cuts across and he says something in Kannada, which I later realized that it was some bad word in Kannada. He came across, said something, and he went off. My friend was like, "Arey, this guy is abusing us." The other guy was like, "Let's stop him." I'm like, I was like, "Dude, what did he say?" Like, both of them are looking at each other and saying, "We don't know." I'm like, "You don't know? He just looking at the voice, you can't go and fight with someone." And it didn't hurt me as well. Whatever he said, he felt it. He said it to us and he went off. I did not feel anything unless it was something I could understand. So let's chill, let's go have some coffee and go home. So that's the time when I realized, no matter what, if somebody says that bad words to us, and if I'm able to understand it, then I would definitely react. But if somebody is talking in some other language, they are saying bad words, unless I see them really and their proper actions, which could give me a signal as to what they're saying, again, I would react. But if I'm not understanding, why would I react? And that was something, and which that was one reason I did not learn the language. Maybe I'm giving a lame excuse, but yeah, that was one great experience that I had. And I think sometime after that, because of language problem, right? I'm moving towards a different direction, because I have experienced Kannada, I've experienced Tamil, I've experienced Telugu, and all these languages are so different than Hindi. I mean, and now in Pune and Marathi is almost like Hindi, we can understand it, but it's very difficult in any of the South Indian language. In fact, even Malayalam, right? I've experienced all four of them. And when I wrote an article about communication, and because I had experienced a situation where groupism was one of the big topic within my company, the company that I was working for, and people were talking about how to dissolve this groupism and all that. And that time I was like, why is this happening? I was trying to think of it, and then I realized that people with different language background and their society or the social culture that they have, everybody is trying to be within their group, and it's unfair from anybody's point of view that let's break it. I mean, what are you going to get out of it? They are comfortable, at least you're getting what the job is done. But every time that they had to interact with the other party, right? If let's say I'm the SME and they're supposed to interact with me, it would be a difficult task because there is no rapport. And that's when I realized having that common dialect or a common language would help. So yeah, maybe I'll share the link. That was like one of the kiddish article that I wrote long time back. So
cool. I just moving to a different topic here on the same context. I was just reading a book or rather an article about the CEO of audiobooks.
Okay.
Quite often we listen to Audible books, and instead of reading and spending time there, we listen to the audiobooks and then figure out what's their story. We tend to understand what the person is saying, and you try to decipher and understand the context there.
Right.
So one of the core thing in audiobooks primarily is what particular words that you're going to use in your communication. And that's one of the core values on the same company. And I was just reading an article from their CEO, and kind of very thrilling and exciting to see how the whole company is built on certain core values, particularly on choices of words.
Okay.
Yep. And I would recommend, I probably share the article link. I would recommend you to read that article, and it will be pretty interesting to understand how the whole company value is built on the choices of word, how one can use particular words to build a business there. And when you're listening to something, right, for example songs, or maybe you're watching movies, or maybe a series or something like that,
right,
quite often we tend to remember a phrase in from that movie, or maybe a sentence from that particular audiobooks, right? And that is because when we listen to certain things which we like the most and we understand it clearly in the layman language, we tend to remember it forever. And that is when your moment of truth comes in play. You figure out certain things, you understand that part, and it kind of stamps in your brain for a lifetime. To me, the summary is, what words you use to communicate is the key and important thing, especially imagine the situation when everybody is working remotely, they can't see each other except virtual meetings. They have to use proper words so that the other person does not feel bad about it, and at the same time, you still convey your message there. So how do you use certain words, choices of words, context, and little bit of psychology about how mind perceives certain words is something pretty important in our daily life and in professional life as well. And using some of the models that we talked about in the corporate story, did well and do differently, is something that one can use to talk to or maybe communicate to his or her peers in his company, his or her company.
Absolutely. And from my point of view, what I believe is, whenever we are talking with anyone, and if we want to have a fruitful relationship, get positive outcomes, we should put a conscious effort in choosing the words that we are going to use. And there are times when we get emotional, whether we are sad, whether we are super happy, or whether we are angry. If the emotion is taking over, then there is a challenge, and we kind of slip and say things that we repent later. So that's, I guess that would be another topic for another day when we come back and discuss about emotional intelligence. But that's food for thought for the audience, to ensure that you put in a little bit of conscious effort whenever you're talking with anybody, for that matter. And with that, I think we have summed it up pretty well for everybody to understand the importance of words that we speak, because words can kill after all.